All right, at 7:01, we'll call the Conway Selectboard meeting to order for March 28th. First item on our agenda is the minutes for March 14th. However, they have not been properly reviewed, and we're going to table those minutes until the next meeting. Next item, meetings attended by Select Board members. Do we have any meetings?
Not this time.
Okay. Citizens' concerns. Do we have any citizens' concerns? Seeing none, we'll move on. Old business. Town meeting warrant. Items so far. Tom?
Just a few changes. You should have it in your packet. It's like this, four items on it. As we'll hear from Dana, the fire pumper articles, we've gotten a recommendation from the Capital Improvement Planning Committee, and so those are on as the first set of changes. Slight change in the wording to the request for helping pay the legal expenses of Montague's intervention in the DPU matter. I have gotten final figures included now in the community preservation article. Those hadn't been calculated last time. And Ron Sweet is suggesting a new article under highway to transfer, because we've had such a light winter, and we know we need work done on Delabar Avenue. He's suggesting that we transfer money from the winter roads account to a special account for engineering work on Delabar Avenue, which would get that done for us. The estimated cost of the project is $250,000 to $300,000, so it's less than we thought. The engineering
$250,000.
Oh, that is much less than I thought it was going to be.
So, really?
That's okay. Excellent news.
Wow.
And so the money, it's $42,000, would take care of all of the permitting, engineering, and it would also include them applying for us for a emergency management grant, hazard mitigation grant, that would pay 75% of the cost with a 25% match. Don't know that we're going to get that, but that would be part of the money that we would be paying them out of this transferred winter road. So I've been working with him on that and did include it in the draft warrant, but again, that's the whole thing's up for review. And those are the changes to the warrant from the last time.
Okay, now on the Delabar Road project, when would we know we were getting something from NEMA?
Well, the deadline for application is the end of May.
Okay.
I don't know what their structure is. Sometime during the summer, before fall, we would hope to get it before fall. I don't think we'd be looking at this construction period for actually doing the work.
All right, so if it was $300,000, our piece of that would be $75,000?
75%.
No.
Our
piece would be $75,000.
Yes.
We would have 42 of that if we got the grant. So our exposure there would be basically $33,000 total compared to that 42.
No, the $300,000 does not include the engineering work. That's the construction work.
That's just construction. What's engineering going to cost?
$42,000.
Oh, we know that's the engineering cost?
Yeah, we got an estimate.
Oh, we got an estimate.
Very,
okay.
Very thorough estimate, yeah.
So we put in 42, we're still going to have to pay 75 and at 300,000.
Yeah.
If we get the grant.
And we save the road.
And we save the road.
Is the superintendent going to do something if this is not going to be done this construction season?
Yeah.
Is he going to do something to prevent any further damage between now and when it's done?
Yeah, we got it.
Because the road is...
We have a good plan for
that. The edge is in tough shape right now.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. And the bank below it, too, which is going to contribute to further...
We may just want to close that temporarily, part of it, that section.
It's conceivable. We have cones up now.
Mm-hmm.
We can consider that, yeah. I'll bring that to you.
You know, there's, what about a 50-foot section we could close from the corner of Delabar there, right?
Well, there's two spots, so it would actually be probably a couple tenths of a mile.
This project costs us for both areas?
Yes. It would be considered one project.
All right, but we're not going to spend anything on engineering till we know whether we have the grant or not, right?
The engineering would be the way that we would get the grant. They would do the grant for us if we paid them to do the engineering, which would also give us a real figure for what it would cost.
So we're going to have to spend $42,000. We don't know what the whole project is going to cost, and then we may not get a grant.
Right.
Well, we know it's not going to... We have a good idea that it would not exceed $300,000. And we do have money available now because the winter... This is a little over half of his salt money that he didn't have to spend this year, mm-hmm. that he does have available in his budget. So we can talk about that further as we go through the warrant with the Finance Committee as well.
Okay. Also on Montague, on Montague for legal fees, have we figured out what the benefit of Conway is for us getting involved in that?
The argument that I've heard is that the legal fees are for helping to determine whether or not the figures show that the pipeline is needed. And if it shows that the demand is less than it has been projected to be, then the pipeline would have less of a chance of getting approved.
But Montague also wants gas brought down into their town, correct?
This is something internal to the politics of Montague that I don't know how that's playing out. I do know that they do have a donations account for people to put this money into.
They're a customer.
They're a customer of Berkshire Gas, and they want more.
They have
Berkshire Gas, right?
I don't know that they want more. They would just like to know what the claim is by Tennessee Gas that they have enough customers to make this worth all our while.
And specifically about the Eversource. How much Eversource is demanding. This is confidential business information, so only the attorney for Montague and perhaps one other person would be allowed actually to see the figure, and all of the comments on it would have to be confidential as well.
How much Eversource is demanding?
Yeah. That's the driver of this. They might get access to other demand documents as well, but that's the driver for it, as I understand it.
All right. Thanks, Tom. And any other questions on these?
The only question I have is on the fire truck one. We haven't got a definitive price yet. Once again, to help to have that concrete locked in price. We were hoping to meet last week with him, but he has not, he had to cancel because he was away on vacation, but he is coming, and I was going to invite Mr. Goodfield. We'd like to come up Wednesday night to the firehouse. And I'm hoping that's enough money, but I don't have the concrete figures until then.
That's giving you a little bargaining negotiating chip, Bob.
Well.
Yeah. Do we need to change that figure?
I can't tell you that till after Wednesday night.
Well, we got to approve it tonight. Yeah. So, what's your best guess on that? Do you want to bump it up to 200?
To 400.
So, we want to make that 185, 200?
200, I would say.
Okay.
First one's 200, right? Pay a portion of the cost for purchasing a pumper.
I thought you had it under 400, Bob.
Well, we did, but it wasn't a concrete locked-in figure at that point. It was an estimate from the factory. And there had to be other costs added in there, like, I just found this out this past week. Because it's not going to be, it's bid through Fire Chiefs Association of Massachusetts. They have a maintenance fee that if you bid a truck through them, that paid for them putting this all together, back it together. I don't know what that is.
Could be a couple thousand.
All right, so 400 gives you a comfort level in this?
I would say a pretty comfortable level.
Okay. Any other questions on these changes? All right. Next item on the agenda is to approve the parade on April 30th for the Cal Ripken baseball season start. Tom, what do we have to do on that in terms of the town? Alert Ken?
Yes, and Ken is fully aware of this. I believe Mike Kirkalonis just wanted formal select board approval, knowledge, publicity about the event.
Okay, so the only thing we're taking care of is, are we taking care of any traffic?
That would be detail, and that's up to Ken and the Cal Ripken. I don't know. It could be that Ken will put it on town duty. I haven't spoken with him about that in particular. I do know we are providing porta potties for the event.
Okay.
That was approved earlier.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Any questions on this particular item?
I guess it's a pretty big thing from what I said. Last year they had to kick out parade in one of the valley towns, and they said there's well over 100 kids participating.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Plus all the parents.
Oh, I think it's a good thing for the town.
It kicks off all the baseball season, not just the Cal Ripken, but all the whole.
Right.
We'll see.
I just want to make sure what it's costing us to do this.
Ken, I don't have a dollar figure. I do know Ken is comfortable with it happening.
Okay, so he's got it under control.
Yeah.
Okay, and he's coordinating with Mike.
Yes.
Okay, fine. I'll make a motion that we approve the parade for April 30th for the Cal Ripken baseball season start.
Second.
Yeah. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Energy Committee. Okay. Bryce, you're up.
Thank you, gentlemen. We've been working with a engineer down in the valley. Lily Barak, who's worked with the town before, and have asked her to sort of design the scope for the bid for the town hall insulation project, of which I believe you have copies up there.
Mm-hmm.
And we've reviewed it and talked about it, and would like the Board of Selectmen to agree to this and to design it and forward this on to Lily so we can get moving on this.
All right, so this is for the redesign of the insulation project for this building?
Yes, it is.
And okay. I think you want to mention the changes that have been made since the last time, because the board was very interested in that.
Okay. Right, basically what happened is the first design was sent out for bid and came in at three times what the budget was. And so we met and tried to figure out another way to do that, which actually was putting the insulation on the inside. In meeting with each other and talking about it, we once again went to look at putting it on the outside with a system called exterior insulation finishing system, which adds rigid insulation to the exterior walls. A weather-resistant barrier first, then the insulation, then some webbing, and then a layer of polymer to give it substance, and another one, and basically they sort of create these templates which create the brick look.
Mm-hmm.
And this, looking at the initial bid on this, it came in to within our budget, of which is going to be supplied by Community Action.
No. Green Communities.
Green Communities.
Right, our Green Community Fund.
That's right.
Right. Okay. Is this as effective as interior insulation?
I would say it's more so. It will create more of an air barrier on the exterior, because you won't really have to be jogging around and all. It'll be less expensive, and I was in looking at it, and in buildings in the county or in the area, there's some you can't really tell what it is, that it's not brick unless you get very close to it.
You've looked at other buildings that have done this?
Yes, over in Shelburne, the Greenfield Savings Bank on the corner there is EFIS, and then down in Florence Savings Bank also had that done.
My question to John was, I'd like to see a building that was done with before we go.
Oh, yeah.
Committing ourselves to it.
I appreciate that very much. As I said, those are two right in the area that I know of. I can get more for you to check out if you'd like. This I'm finding out is being used more and more in commercial buildings, both for its wear as well as its relative affordability versus other methods of adding insulation.
So a new structure would be, you build a frame, like a frame building, and then you put on the insulation and put this on the outside?
No, basically the foam is rigid foam is applied directly to the surface, which they prepared by covering it with a weather-resistant barrier, as well as an epoxy, and then they build up over that with a fiberglass mesh, and then more polymer to sort of give it a good hard coat, and then they go back with the template in place and then give the brick look. And so it's sort of held on directly to the building.
By the way, Lilly's original recommendation was for an exterior insulation, and the Energy Committee rejected that because at that time she was talking about vinyl siding, and we thought the town would not go for a vinyl sided town hall. Bryce knew about this system, and we were thankful to him for alerting us to the fact that you can still do exterior insulation, which is preferable because you don't have to deal with plumbing, you don't have to deal with electrical, you don't have to deal with disturbing. People can keep working while you're insulating. And it looks good. It keeps the...
And any estimates on how it'll increase the R factor?
I've asked to go for an assembly. They'll give us an R20, which is combined with the basically about an R4 of the wall. The existing wall will give you about an R24, which was very close to what Lilly's barracks on first original designs were on the inside.
Okay, so we're getting the same R factor with this as we would with the interior
basically
insulation, and this is less expensive.
Yes, I think it'll be more effective as well.
What's the life of this?
It wears very well. I would say that every so often you might have to resurface it.
Do they give you some sort of a warranty on this?
There is a warranty on it, and I don't have it at hand, but I can get that information for you.
Okay.
Bryce is talking to several vendors, too.
Has any of them vendors have any comments on how to clean that stuff and get dirty? The only reason I asked that is because if you look at our building in particular, that side where the eaves are and that side where the eaves are, the water splashes on the ground and mold comes up on the siding. And how would you get that clean?
I'll also look into that as well. But it should be very cut and dry, very easy, with typical detergents and water.
That would be good to know.
Yeah.
So what you need from us tonight is to go forward with this new estimate?
That's right.
And that'll basically get this process moving again?
Yes, it will. Lilly will be able to redo the bid, and we'll be able to put it out and keep moving forward with this.
Did you say how many years that's been on the market?
In the United States, this has been on the market since the 60s. Yes. In Europe, they've been using it far longer, but I'd say it's first came across probably in the 60s.
Okay.
We went for this look as to, I think you might be more familiar with seeing more buildings with
sort of a plane, all right?
Yes. If you look at most most of your strip malls, like down the Hadley, most of them, I would say, are EFIS.
Mm-hmm.
But we wanted to hold out for this.
Okay, good and... Go ahead,
Bob. Oh, that's a good idea, John.
Okay.
Left out there.
Yeah. And the Energy Committee is recommending that we move forward on that?
Yes.
Any other questions for the Energy Committee on this? All right, I'll make a I'll make a motion that we sign the proposal from Lily Barrack to move forward with the putting together new bid specs for the exterior insulation. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And thank you for continuing to pursue finding a workable solution, hopefully.
Could you get that, Tom, that list of buildings too, Ronnie?
What?
Get that on. Could you get Tom the list of buildings, Ronnie?
Yes. Yep.
That we can look at.
All right, next item on our agenda is Community Action is not here tonight, so we're gonna table that for tonight. And you have an update for us on the technical assistance grant for community-based solar?
Yeah, we got the Meta grant, I forgot when, I guess that was last fall. We did a second RFQ because we had no responses to the first one. The second RFQ we have one response to that. The Energy Committee is going to interview those folks tomorrow. What's that?
Tomorrow night.
Tomorrow night, and we will make our recommendation to forward them to you or not, I guess, at your next meeting, hopefully.
You only got one response?
Only one response, yep.
That's for community solar, for the piece behind the school?
That's correct. This is for the community solar.
Why do you think you only got one response?
In my mind, the state is very generous and they provide a lot of money. In the minds of the consultants, it's not enough money, is what we've been hearing. That in order to do the job that we want them to do, some of the potential consultants have said it's not enough money. And
so this is just a consulting firm.
So what this firm would do, can you say what the name of it is? It's public information, right?
Yeah.
It's Co-op Power are the ones who bid on this.
Oh, right, sure.
And we set it up so that it was a two-phase process. The first phase is to say, is this at all feasible? And so I can't remember the number offhand, but I think about 3,000 or 4,000 of the 12,000 is to study the town, study the site, study the business model that we might be able to use. Is this a feasible thing to do in Conway? Would this be good for the town? Would it be good for the townspeople? And does the engineering work out in terms of, is there a viable space to have these solar panels?
What's the recommendation for the number of kilowatts this would produce?
We were looking, I think, around 500 kilowatts. I think we gave a range, and I am forgetting off the top of my head. But
400 to 500 bucks?
Is that what I said?
I think somewhere 400 to 500.
Apparently, if you go over 500 kilowatts, it ramps things up very significantly in terms of the infrastructure. So that's what we're aiming towards. If the Energy Committee and the Select Board are happy with what the initial study shows, then we would engage them for part two, which would be to actually come up with a solid business plan and a bid-ready specs to go out to bid to have somebody build the array and go from there.
Any idea on outtakers for that? Who's going to take the power?
Who would take the power?
Yeah.
What our initial idea is that half of it would be, half of the array would either be owned by the town, and that would obviously involve a lot of conversation, or by a private entity who would then sell power to the town. So half of the array would provide power to the school, let's say.
Right.
The other half of the array would be sold to individual people in a community shared solar model.
Right.
So that folks who don't have a roof or a backyard to be able to put solar panels up but want solar power would be able to buy a share of this array. And it works just the same, apparently. You don't have to have the power on your roof to provide power to your house. And so that's the model we thought of, but we're not experts. That's why we're hiring the experts and say, is this a realistic model for this town, for this time? There's all kinds of turmoil happening legislatively with SRECs and with net metering and net metering agreements. Does this help us create a model that would do these things? We also want to, and again, we don't know if this is realistic, but we really want to provide a structure where there would be some sort of sliding fee, and folks who can't afford to buy panels might be able to get the benefit of the power to defray some of the costs of their electricity as well. And that would not be a big part of the production, but it would be. We'd like some component having to do with helping folks who don't have
parents. Private funded.
So that's the big question.
People?
I'm sorry?
By the people?
So half of it would be funded by individual, by you and me. And then how is the other half paid for? One model would be the town would borrow and own half of the array. Mm-hmm. And the payback on that, we would want our solar consultants to tell us, but the payback is 6 or 7 or 8, 10 years, whatever it is. And then the rest becomes gravy for the town. Frankly, that's the model I personally would advocate. Without full information right now, I would like that, but I'd like to get more information. Or to have an investor or a developer own the half of the array and sell the power to the town. So the town has no upfront costs, but the advantage to the town is less, ultimately, I think, in terms of savings from the electricity.
And any idea of the interest among our residents to purchase?
Well, Bryce has been doing a lot on that.
This is dovetailing nicely with the solarized mass program we're doing with Coleraine and Shelburne. And there are a number of people in town who do not have good solar exposure, don't want to put it on the roofs or on their ground sites, so are seeing that having this as an alternative is getting quite a bit of interest, more so than piggybacking with a neighbor.
Okay.
So I think that this will give us a nice feed in.
But frankly, part of what we're going to ask the consultants to do in this first phase is to help us measure the level of interest there is in the town.
Okay. Yeah, another thing that's being done is looking into some of these interfaces, some of which can be quite difficult, like the town having someone else buy it, and then that someone else might go out of business, might, you know, not service the farm as best as well as the town would like. And also Peter Martin, if he were here, would be quite eloquent on how difficult it is to get mini grids, microgrids around in neighborhoods, because that requires, again, an interface of people who may or may not get along on other levels, or it just opens a possibility of more trouble. In either of those alternatives.
You have money set aside for the initial cost of having this startup engineering done?
So this was the Meta grant. Do you remember you folks approved us writing a grant back in the fall?
Okay, so that's from the state. All that cost?
That's the $12,000 that is paying for this.
Good. Okay. Any other questions for the Energy Committee? Mm-hmm. Great work. Thank you very much. Next item on the agenda, you're up.
I'll just sneak over here, if you don't mind. Good evening. I'll try to keep this brief, and I've got a meeting at 7:30. Town of Deerfield is looking to do a request for proposals for public access television services, PEG access. And we are doing this in cooperation with the towns of Sunderland and Whately. And we wanted to know if Conway wanted to be in on this process as well. Here's a bit of the background, the 30-second elevator speech. The DOR is changing it the way towns need to manage PEG access monies. The monies that we get through the franchise agreement from the cable provider to pay for PEG access services. That money has to be declared. It has to go into a town's budget. It has to be appropriated by town meeting. And as a result, it also means that anything purchased with those monies has to be done using Chapter 30B procedures, public procurement. Town of Deerfield is therefore putting together an RFP for PEG access services. We want to kick it off in a week or less, as soon as possible. We're actually just waiting for tonight, basically, to hear from you folks. The reason why we're doing this through a third-party consultant is simply because my history. I can't run the RFP on behalf of the town of Deerfield because I've been involved with the public access TV that's been serving the towns for many years. And so I've spoken with Wendy Foxman, whom I believe you already know. She served as interim town administrator in Deerfield and has served in a lot of other towns in a variety of capacities. She's agreed to run the procurement, which will include the advertising, the receipt of the RFP packages from respondents, and the assessment, and then finally a recommendation which she will give to the towns. We want to make sure that Conway has an opportunity to be a part of it. You don't have to choose the end result of the procurement. Any decision for Conway will still come back to you for final choosing. You'll have the opportunity to pick the provider that you want. I would like to know now if you'd like to be a part of the beginning process, because then we will write it into the RFP document.
So this means that FCAT basically is going to compete with other providers for the business of Deerfield, Sunderland, Waitley, and Conway?
If there are other providers that respond to the RFP, then yes. By doing this as an RFP, you said the right word, competition. Mm-hmm. We open it up to public notice, and we offer the opportunity for competition. It's a way to bless any public procurement.
Now, FCAT's been around for how many years now?
12, I believe.
12 years.
Yeah.
And is basically entrenched in the four towns, Deerfield, Waitley, Sunderland, Conway.
Absolutely.
What are the chances of someone else coming in and bidding for cable access TV in our towns?
I think it would be extremely unlikely. My guess
but
is...
But we still have to go through a 30B process?
Exactly.
So...
It's ridiculous. I agree.
I don't understand why DOR is doing that. Because all over the Commonwealth,
yep.
You have local access TV
yep.
That's done by the towns
yep.
Or several towns as we do it.
Right.
And it's been that way for 25 years, maybe?
Yep.
Okay, so longer. Now yep. They're saying it has to be 30B?
Correct.
That's ridiculous.
It is ridiculous. It's entirely ridiculous. I don't disagree. And even federal law says that monies that come from a franchise agreement can only be used for one thing, PEG access.
Mm-hmm.
And historically, towns have basically treated this as an energy services contract, which are exempt from 30B. But in several people that I've spoken to at DOR, they say that this is not the case.
All right, so basically Deerfield wants to do an RFP, mm-hmm. They're put it out there. FCAT will answer that RFP, and chances are nobody else will. And then it'll continue to go on the way it's been going on for the last 12 years.
Correct. The only difference is we will have met procurement requirements, and we can sign the contract, and no one can ever come back and say we didn't.
Yeah. All right, so this is more of a formality than anything else.
I would say yes. My instinct would be
this. This would be a good item to keep on a list for 30B revisions.
Yes.
As would the fact that we have to negotiate our cable contract in public. But we can't have private meetings we can't have executive session to discuss cable contracts.
Oh, we always had open meetings with our cable committee for our negotiations with Congress.
Strategy and all of that. Mm-hmm. That would be another one to look at.
Okay.
Yeah.
Question, is this like another form of tax?
by the DOR?
No, it's just it's essentially just a rule that they're saying we have to follow.
Yeah. Does this come down from a federal
Doesn't cost any
rule?
No, it's state.
Just the, it's the state. Commonwealth?
Yep, yep.
They just dreamed this up just recently?
The DOR rules went into effect about 2 years ago in terms of how the money has to be handled, mm-hmm. and that's what triggered the 30B inclusion. Because prior to this, the monies that come from the franchise agreement were treated as sort of special fund monies sure. and were outside of public procurement and public oversight by the legislative body. Mm-hmm. But now this has to be approved by town meeting. Any procurement has to be done publicly through 30B procedures. And I've spoken at length with our accountant, and she's spoken at length with her representatives at the state level, and they're all coming back with the same information.
What's the underlying motivation for this, do we know?
To make our lives tougher. What government is good for, getting in a man's way.
So this is yeah. also reflected in Article 26 right. of the warrant, which is the sort of bureaucratic counterpart to this process.
Right.
To basically authorize the board to enter into the contract for it. Yeah.
Okay, and Deerfield's taking the lead on this.
We're taking the lead. We're using PEG access reserves to pay for the procurement.
Right.
I've got a draft copy of the contract with Wendy. She says it will be $1,000, probably less, $50 an hour, no more than 20 hours. And again, Deerfield's going to pay for that because we have to do it anyways.
Yeah.
But it'll be more beneficial for all the towns to be able to tie into the same procurement.
Sure.
One procurement satisfies the need for, you know, for all four towns. So.
Right. Okay. All right. Everybody understand what's happening?
The first time I a while ago, we were discussing part of that big access money being used for upgrading our own websites and stuff.
Yeah, that
will all go by the wayside?
No, that has nothing to do with what we're doing
here. That's still allowed. That's still acceptable.
That's still acceptable.
Correct.
Yes.
And if and if you're using it under $10,000, the procurement rules are very, very easy. You get bids, and that's what you're going to go. So, yeah.
Okay. All right. I'll make a motion that we join with Deerfield in the RFP for PEG access. Can I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Gentlemen, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have a great day. Nice to be back.
And you'll keep in touch with Tom.
I will, of course. All right. Absolutely.
Great. Thank you, Doug.
Yep.
Next item on the agenda. Timing was great, Finance Committee. You're up.
If I can just make a preliminary comment and hand out your preliminary sheet. I gave some of these to Jim as well. Unfortunately, I scribbled on yours, and then I realized that everything that I scribbled was wrong. So I've scribbled out my scribbles, and the original figures that are on here stand.
Is that different than the one we have in our packet?
Yes.
Okay.
This shows all of the money articles that we have now. It shows the original budget, or not the original budget, but a summary of that in the second table, talking about the average tax bill. And then it compares it with what I had in my original budget. My original budget was only $22,000 below the levy limit. Since then, we've only added things. No, we haven't only added things. We've actually deleted more things than we've added, which is the good news. At the very bottom, you can see the notes. Expense deletions since the budget, total $197,000. Expense additions since the budget, total $70,000, almost $71,000. So the budget requests that we have in these money articles are down $126,000, which is really good because in general, the budget is up $103,000, almost $104,000. This leaves us about $11,000 in the black. That said, that was using the $185,000 figure for the fire pumper. So we can make up $10,000 of that. That would push us right to the edge. So that's something that I wanted just to be on the table as we go forward and talk about everything.
Okay.
So the Finance Committee has completed our recommendations for Article 2. And the numbers, Tom, that you presented on this handout that was on the table when we came in, jive with up to within $100 of the number that we've been looking at. It looks like the difference is the insurance. I thought that the new number was be...
What are you looking at, then?
Well, the Finance Committee, I have a spreadsheet that I run on my computer, and I keep track of all this. And Tom's got, you know, this other thing, this Word document, or whatever it is, the warrant.
You're talking about Article 2.
Article 2, yeah.
Okay.
So I'm not sure, I mean, that's just a $100 difference. I'm not sure what happened with that, but...
And that was because in the past, we have occasionally been asked to give a certificate of insurance for various things. In the past, we have for the Festival of the Hills. It's cost us $100 to be listed as... To take on the parking that was done for the Festival of the Hills. It's always possible that for something we'll be asked for an extra amount, and rather than having to go to the reserve fund for it, I thought I would put that contingency, since it was only $100, into the budget itself.
Okay, so it doesn't look like it made this version then?
No, I actually went with your advice. But that was why I put it in the beginning.
So last meeting, finance had approved everything down to 294. Is that correct?
I'm sorry. I'm going to answer. Roy's got to point out there's a number that I missed or something here.
No,
so I took 295904.
No, I'm looking here.
I took this number here, the delta, the change.
Oh, I don't. Oh, yours. Yeah. Okay, I got you.
And I subtracted the salary and wage adjustment.
Okay.
12,327. And I get 283,577, and he's got 283,477.
Okay.
So there's a $100
yeah.
difference somewhere,
okay.
and it's just that
yeah. okay.
delta on the town insurance. So, I mean, we just made our recommendation based on the information we had. It was for the figure that was $100 higher. So if you want to just...
Last meeting, you agreed with everything up to 294, correct?
So actually, this meeting, yeah, I don't know exactly where we were at, but we've covered the entire Article 2 now. So it's all recommended, with the exception, and most of it was voted unanimously. The only one we got hung up on was the Department of Parks and Rec, where we have no decision. We have no recommendation on their budget.
Okay, so this Article 2 you have in front of you, you're in agreement with everything on this?
Except for
is that
630.
Correct?
Setting aside the salary wage increase as well, which isn't baked in here.
It's not baked in here anywhere.
Right.
Which is difficult with the new, if we approve all of the other spending articles.
Well, you know, I think Tom's talking about the levy limit, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, I worked up an examination of the levy limit separately from Tom. I'm not sure that we're that close. I also noticed, Tom, that you've double counted the 15 grand for the ambulance. It's on Article 2, and it's on Article, you've got it as a raise and appropriate in your...
Number 12.
Your tally, wherever that is. 12. Article 8, I think.
12.
Yeah.
Oh.
So, I mean, Article 8 shouldn't be raised inappropriate. It's just transfer from receipts reserves to...
it's a transfer.
Whatever.
And that's... we have a new warrant now. Do they have the new warrant? Yeah, okay. So that's... Operating expenses, Article 12.
In the packet I looked at.
So you dropped it from Article 2?
No. I'm saying that in the warrant, Article 12 is providing $15,000 for operating expenses for the ambulance department.
Yeah, which,
and you're saying we don't need
we're
that.
We're just going to take out the words raise and appropriate, right?
Well, no. Well, we're going to take out the whole article.
No, you're going to leave it in because we need to move the money. We need to vote to move the money from receipts reserved to ambulance operating, whatever it's called.
So it's going to read to see if the town will transfer from available funds, not raise and appropriate,
right.
Correct? Right.
There are two different articles, Article 11 and Article 12.
Yep, and
Article 11 transfers.
They're both transfers.
Oh, okay.
One of them is transfer from receipts reserved to stabilization. The other one's transfer from receipts reserved to defray the cost of their operating budget.
So we're taking out raise and appropriate from 11 as well.
Well, that will be in the motion. That'll be in the motion. That's fine.
Tom, on Article 2, line 231.
Right. Now, we had that last year. Did we?
The ambulance operating budget is going to be the combination of the $15,000 and the 20.
Yep.
21,970.
No, that's the stabilization. Hang on a second. I have it on my thing. Oh. I mean, basically, the lower for the ambulance, it's their budget minus $15,000. That's what we need to transfer to their operating budget. And their budget is not any number on these sheets anywhere. It's going to be, it's the number we cooked up with them. And I have it somewhere, but
Did we not raise and appropriate $15,000 for them last year?
Yeah, we always raise and appropriate it, but it's on Article 2.
Right, and that is on Article 2.
Yep. So we're not raising.
We have Article 11, which is for $21,972.
Which is for stabilization.
And that's going to stabilization.
Correct.
So you're saying we need money going from stabilization?
No,
we don't.
It's reserved. All their money accumulates.
Money from receipts reserved to their operating.
I mean, we can take this offline. It's pretty straightforward. Yeah. It's just the money's here, and we got to move it to the two other places that we need it. And we're voting Article 2, $15,000.
Right.
So, but I just noticed that on here, had $15,000 as a separate article, raise and appropriate, and that's double dipping. It's not on this table that you handed out.
Oh,
you've
on the table.
You've got $15,000 on listed as raise and appropriate for Article 12.
Well,
already in Article 2.
Oh, so that should be a transfer?
Yes.
Is it still $15,000?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's transfer from stabilization.
But over here it is worded the word
from receipts reserved to operate.
Yeah, but the way you can tell. Okay, so. I think now that we've settled that, the other piece that's outstanding on Article 2 is just basically a salary and wage increase. And Finance Committee looked at it earlier. We got the chart showing what the total would be if we did from a 1% up to a 3%, and we recommended 2% across the board, which is about just over $12,000 total for the town.
All right, but everything else on Article 2, you guys are okay with?
With the exception of the Parks and Rec, where we were hung, no recommendation. So I'm not sure how we're going to represent that on the warrant, but.
All right, you can just say no recommendation.
I'll say no recommendation, and you can say you were hung, if anyone asks.
All right.
You mean it was a split decision? Is that what you mean?
Two in favor, one against, and one undecided, so
okay,
it wasn't
non-substantial, so, you know, that's all right. All right, Do you guys want to go over these or the money articles?
Well, that's where we haven't really had a chance to fully engage with our recommendations. We did notice, though, that there's a new one.
You realize we need your recommendations tonight.
Yeah. So I guess we're going to make them here with you guys.
Okay.
But we did notice there's a pretty big one that's we hadn't seen before. And that's Article 8. $42,000 transfer from Winter Roads, fixed Delabarre Ave.
That is new as of today. And this is because the winter roads have been very easy this year, or not easy, but not expensive. There's a lot of money left in the salt budget this year. And Delabarre work needs a lot. Delabarre Ave needs serious work. And we did get an estimate from an engineering firm, which was $42,000, $41,900, something like that, for work that would include the engineering, the permitting, and also applying for a hazard mitigation grant, a FEMA hazard mitigation grant that would be a 75% payment for the construction. So I put that on there because it would be a relatively painless way to finance that engineering work. And I'm sorry, it did come up just this afternoon, so I haven't had a chance to. I mentioned it a little bit to the select board before, but that is a new item. Since it's a transfer of this year's funds, it shouldn't affect next year's finances, except insofar as it won't come back as
free cash. That's right.
But we don't really count on Winter Roads money coming back as free cash anyway, typically.
So the one interesting wrinkle this year that we haven't had in prior years is that we don't have we don't have the significant free cash level that we've had in other years, where we've been able to basically fund all the special spending articles from free cash. So this year we have the privilege of putting, right, this is, we've been working on that for a number of years.
Yeah.
So now we have the interesting question of, well, picking and choosing which articles ought to be funded from free cash and which ones will wind up going on the levy. Certainly there is arguments to be made either way for some of the stuff, I don't think that we need our decision on the funding source does not need to be part of our recommendation tonight, I believe, because that's the funding source is going to be open on the warrant. We'll need to to solidify that in time for town meeting for the motion. So basically what we need to do tonight is just decide, is finance committee or select board or both giving a thumbs up or a thumbs down or no recommendation to this list of stuff.
All right, let's go over the list one at a time.
Sure.
Article 3. What's your recommendation on that?
So these are the pumper articles?
Right. 4. Right.
Yeah, there's going to be a change to 4. Let's just do 3.
Well, and did the select board decide that they're okay with the finance committee recommendations on Article 2? And perhaps Parks and Rec, or are you going to do that later?
You're okay with Article 2, except for Parks and Rec.
Correct.
Okay, that's fine.
Can I put that down as a select board recommendation of 3-0 for
absolutely
Article 2?
Yeah.
Your stance on the salary and wage adjustment is the same.
You're recommending 2%.
That's what we said.
Is that listed in here?
No,
it's not
in there yet.
It will have to be. All of that will have to be changed.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it'll go up.
12,000.
Yeah.
All right. Are we?
Thank you.
Are we in agreement on 2% across the board?
That can eliminate that other
Yeah.
At this point, it will. We need to do more on that.
I'm a favorite.
All right. All right, we'll make a recommendation that we'll go for a 2% across-the-board increase on salaries.
Okay.
Have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, so we're ready to go on to Article 3?
Sure. I mean, we've seen the recommendation from the Capital Committee.
Mm-hmm.
So...
David, do you want to get in here?
Well, yeah, our recommendation is $385,000, and the board has decided they want to bump it to $400,000. So, I mean...
The only reason we're doing that is that Bob doesn't have a solid figure.
Well, this is going to help him get one.
Okay, so you think that if we put 385 in here, that'll help Bob negotiate down to 385?
What if it?
Well, okay, but if that doesn't happen, then you know.
Well, I can promise you one thing: if we leave it at 400, it will be 400.
Well, Bob can negotiate 385.
Well, once you say 400,
what we put in here and what Bob negotiates for are two different things.
Oh, you think we're going to keep this a big secret?
Why not? He's doing this on Wednesday night.
Uh-huh.
Right? This warrant is...
We're going to have an absolute figure Wednesday night?
I'm guaranteed.
But you have no idea what it's going to be.
I believe it'll be the 300 range, between 400.
Well, 385 sounds good to me. That's what the committee recommends, so you guys do what you want to do. But.
Well, the other part of that was, as Dana had suggested we look into, was if prior to all of this, if we paid a significant chunk of that... Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but that has nothing to do with the purchase price.
Right, but it might be an incentive to lower it.
Dana, we respect your recommendation, yeah. And you know, we certainly want Bob to get that price. We've got to have this done tonight.
Well, you don't have to sign it till next week. You could recommend 385 tonight, and then Bob...
We don't have to sign this tonight?
No. You can sign it next... Yeah, you can sign it next week.
So we're not finalizing this until next week?
I would like it finalized tonight, but this is an example of where it doesn't...
So we've got to come up with a number tonight.
It would be helpful to say 385 tonight, and then if Bob can't negotiate that, we can talk about it next week.
Okay, let's do that.
Okay, all right. We'll leave it at your recommendation.
My intent, okay. Bob, is if I'm going to meet with you Wednesday night with this guy, just make me the bad guy and say his committee is the one who's...
You may be fine with that figure, but at this point, I don't have a concrete evidence to say that.
You guys are going to tag team to make this happen?
I'm going to work the guy over Wednesday.
Okay, got confidence in you.
So let's leave it at 385.
All right. And
it has to be changed. We'll come back for another minute.
All right. Sure. That's good. All right.
Okay.
So what's your recommendation on 3?
Well, gang, do you want to? Are we ready? Or
I agree with
motion.
Should we discuss?
All right. So I move that the Finance Committee recommends Article 3, appropriate $200,000. They're going to borrow it, right?
Dana, do you want to give us some background here?
There's some things that we think you ought to consider. Obviously, we can go out and borrow $200,000. Bob, in discussion with some of these people, there's a possibility that if we paid a portion up front, there's a reduction in the price. So that's something we need to look at. The other thing that came up, and Roy, I don't know, were you the one that came brought up about the leasing?
Well, we talked about it. I didn't bring it up.
Well, the town of Greenfield leases all their vehicles, fire trucks, police cars, I suppose highway departments. That might be an attractive thing to look at. Now, how that works into warrants, I don't know.
That's a five-year, I believe they call it a five-year ownership at the end of lease, right?
Who was it that brought that up? Came out of, they do it for the life of the vehicle, 20 years.
They do.
Or they could do 10-year with a buyout at the end of 10 years, which would be significantly less than taking a whack all at once.
We would have to have the whole plan in front of us and approved next week.
I don't understand all this stuff, but I went home and Googled leasing. It sounds awfully expensive to me.
Well, it isn't.
Okay.
Leasing, a very simplified explanation of leasing is you pay the depreciation as you incur it. That's why we don't all own power companies. We pay for what we use every month. And with a lease, you're paying the depreciation on the item on a monthly basis as it's incurred. So it's, I mean, it's no more expensive or less expensive than purchasing something. It's just how you fund it. That's why people don't go out and buy $80,000 cars the way they used to. They lease them. So there's like a 50% residual value. They're paying 50% of that $80,000 while they've got the vehicle. So. What we would in the case of expensive things like a fire truck, it might be worth taking a look at.
What we would need would be a total cost, so the town meeting could approve the total cost for the lease that we would sign.
Would you like me to look into this and have an answer for you next week on what the lease situation, maybe it doesn't work, I don't know, but.
Is this something you would talk about on Wednesday night?
Yeah. Yes, yeah. With him also. Yeah.
This guy must have heard of it. Your representative from the fire company, he must know about it.
Mm-hmm. Have you spoken with someone in Greenfield about it?
Who brought that up?
I don't remember. Do you remember who brought that one up? The leasing?
Tony.
I heard Bob bring it up.
What I found equally is compelling, and the committee here probably doesn't even know this, that there's a long lead time on a truck of this.
Yes, 8 to 10 months.
Eight to 10 months, and that's why the discussion about providing a more substantial deposit will help the assembler, the manufacturer, put it together and, you know, reduce their cost of capital and maybe get a discount passed on to us. Mm-hmm. It depends on how hungry they are for money as to what kind of a discount they'll give you.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
All right, well, that's something we have to discuss further. But right now, what we're talking about is
$200,000. Yeah.
Worst case situation, we have to borrow that, right? Is that worst case? Okay. And then the other is...
Why is that worst case? I mean, I thought we were looking at this earlier, and I thought that was going to... The multi-year, the capital plan, the vehicle spreadsheet has,
Well, that wipes it out.
That has... couple $300,000 in it, right, for this truck?
Well, it's not just for this truck, no.
It's not earmarked. There's nothing earmarked.
No, but the cell that represented the replacement of this truck, what was the dollar amount that we were tracking?
That was $300,
right?
It was in the plan originally.
And we're sticking $125 a year in that thing to try to keep that funded with all the other replacements. Of course, Highway's done their thing trying to, reduce the cost. So I thought that we had... But that plan at $125,000 a year was sufficient to cover the $300,000 for out of stabilization. And here we're dropping it to $185,000. So is there a decision that we don't need all that money, that we need that money for something else in the vehicle plan? Or something
I'm not aware of the fact that there was $125,000 a year put away for a fire truck.
Not for a fire truck, for the capital stabilization account.
All right.
For all the vehicles. So we've been doing that.
What's the balance in that account, Tom?
All the highway and fire.
I don't have it with me, but it was
three something.
Yeah,
I think it was 375.
But that's
and we're putting another 125 in this year. You got the special.
I think what our thoughts were that we're going to be looking at if you look at the plan going forward, I think we're going to be spending more money than we're accumulating in that account.
Okay.
Our thought was that there should be a stabilization account for the fire department and the highway department.
Our
separate.
Our thought? Where is this?
With the committee.
I don't know. Roy's the representative from the finance committee to the capital improvement planning committee, and we haven't really heard, any of this stuff, so,
We didn't, the last meeting, we didn't just...
You were at the other meeting.
I was at the other meeting.
Well, we're a little bit at a disadvantage here, then. My only concern is that this is, granted, you're putting it in as a debt exclusion, so it won't count against us on our Prop 2.5 limits, but it's going on the taxes. You're looking at $200,000 going on the taxes, and we've already got set aside a bunch of money for vehicles, and so...
Well, we had...
I'm just saying, from my perspective, that we should hit that account for the $300,000, and if we need to, borrow or, pull it from general or somewhere else to cover the total, if it's more than $300,000.
Well, so you're concerned, Dana and the rest of the committee
Our
is concerned
concern is
that next year we're going to need more than 125 of highway department vehicles?
Who knows? You've got a bunch of old trucks in the highway department, you've got an old grader. All of a sudden, if one of these trucks tries, I don't think it's unreasonable to think you're going to look at $125,000 for a new highway department. Is that $125,000 for a new dump truck?
If there's an emergency, the general stabilization that's meant to cover emergencies.
Well, maybe I'm being too conservative. I don't know. I get concerned about the fact that, we've gone from having lots of free cash and lots of money to not so much.
And we will be having the long-term planning session in the fall at some point. It's not set yet, but we're going to be able to tackle these issues comprehensively before the next year comes along. So
I got to say, good news too.
All right. So you want to take more money out of stabilization for this?
Well, let me ask you this: what's easier to lease? Is a pumper easier to lease or a grader?
I don't think there's any difference. There's companies that lease heavy equipment. So whatever you want to lease, I'm sure there's somebody out there to do it.
So we would be cleaning this out. And we'd be replacing it with 125 new.
We wouldn't be cleaning it out.
Now the balance in that account is $423,000 right
which
now.
Which account are we talking about?
Capital stabilization.
Capital stabilization. I mean, honestly, Dana, when I said this at the meeting, it's not like we had this free cash and we put most of it into stabilization is what we did. So.
When we had that big year of free cash, we put a lot of money in stabilization.
Yeah, that's okay, what
so
I was saying.
You want to take some of that out rather than do it this way?
Well, we've been putting $125,000, socking it away on an annual basis with the vehicle plan in mind. And that fire truck was on the plan for $300,000. So I think that we should use what we planned for it, yes.
Follow through.
Okay, so what's your recommendation on Article 3?
But
I don't know. We've got to take a vote here with the committee. It's not just my recommendation. So, does anybody else have
what do you think?
Questions about that? I'm basically going to make a motion that we make Article 3. I don't know what happens to Article 3, but Article 4, which is the which is what comes from stabilization. He's got 185
right
there. We bumped that up to 300, and I don't know what you do with the borrowing or the other piece of it.
Lower it.
Put that at, what do you put it at, 85 or 100, or I don't know what you do.
50.
You're going to put it at 85, right, pursuant to the conversation earlier?
Right.
Okay. So that's what we're looking at then.
It's 385.
Is 85 for Article 3,
okay,
is 300 for Article 4.
Okay, I have no problem with that.
Is 300 a lot of money coming out of that account?
Is it a lot?
You want to go up to 300 taken out of that?
Again, there's 423,000 there, and we're putting in another 125,000 on Article the five.
Are we going to have enough money to put in?
250.
Are we going to have enough money to put into that account?
Yeah.
From where are we putting it in from?
Well, you know, that's one of those questions that we'll have to...
We haven't gotten to Article 5 yet.
We've got a little over $150,000 in free cash. Where are we getting $125,000 from to put into capital stabilization?
That's a good question. We can talk about the sources and uses, but, you know, we've got, you know, it's either going to be raise and appropriate or free cash. Yeah. I mean, we don't have enough money in free cash to cover all of the transfers to stabilization this year.
Right, so if you're talking about raise and appropriate to put into capitalization, what's the difference between that and borrowing for the fire truck?
Exactly. Raise and appropriate. The whole difference is you're raising and appropriating versus
yeah,
borrowing.
So you're raising taxes to put it into stabilization.
Right. Versus
well, but there's a plan. There's a had a plan going for vehicles, and there's... And it's been $125,000 a year, and people are accustomed to seeing that. So this year, I mean, we could put that as a free cash, but then you're going to have to put... It's going to be a toss-up. Do you want... What do you want to put on free cash? The highway transfer to stabilization for the highway, or for the fire truck? I mean, or for the grammar school? You know, we can't afford to do it all out of free cash, so...
If you borrow the $200,000, you've spread that over a period of time. If you take it out of capital stabilization, it's banking on the taxes now.
So you're recommending that we don't do... But I thought the Capital Improvement Planning Committee recommended that we fund all the stabilizations to the... You guys didn't make a recommendation on the funding source.
No.
But the report I saw said, recommend grammar school, recommend general stabilization, recommend capital stabilization. Those were all recommended.
Right.
And there's not enough...
Free cash
to cover all those. So some of the things are going to have to be raised and appropriate.
Yeah, as according to this sheet.
Yeah. Yeah.
And Jim and I had talked about, because there's 156 roughly in free cash now, doing the 100 and the 50 out of free cash anyway, it just seemed to be an easy way to slice it up.
Okay.
For the highway and the grammar school.
Right.
And
that's just one. That's just one, you know.
We could put in the library there as well. You know.
All right, so what's your recommendation on 3 and 4?
I would say, I mean, borrowing some and taking some out of stabilization is a sort of middle-of-the-road way to go. But for the record, I also have no problem contemplating a lease that makes sense because here's the problem with a lease. It makes you think like you have more than you really have. Whereas when you pay, and the other side of that is, thing costs $400,000, you pay $400,000, you're that much poorer, and that's the reality.
But you also have to think about this. This is a 25-year fire truck.
Exactly, which is why I say I would entertain a lease or a loan. That was 20 years, not at the time I met, I talked with Tom. He said we were talking 4 or 5 years on the borrowing. If the interest rate was low enough, you know, go out, take it out as long as you want. Putting a good chunk down into it means you won't be, in other words, you won't have junk and still owe on it. You won't be upside down, which is, I think, is as important as anything. So, and that would apply with a lease as well. So in my mind then, borrowing half and taking half out of stabilization, you know, half give or take, it's a middle of the road approach.
Okay, what numbers do you want to put in 3 and 4?
You know, I said half and half.
But that's what they predicted here.
It could be whatever Dana, you know, was suggesting as well.
In general, I would advocate borrowing less than you take out from capital stabilization simply because of the interest paid on the borrowing. That said, the town gets good rates.
Yeah.
That said, it's still a rate.
All right. How about 100 at a 3, 3 at 100, and 4 at 285? How's that? Does that satisfy everybody?
Can you repeat that?
100, borrow 100 on 3 and make it 285 on 4. Is that good?
That's good.
I have no problem.
So does that look good to you, Jim?
So who votes first? Do we vote?
You guys have to recommend that.
Okay. So
285 from capital stabilization and 100,000 to borrow. Yeah. So I move we recommend Article 3 at 100,000. Can I get a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
So there you go.
Unanimous. You got 5-0.
Yep.
Okay.
And then for Article 4, we're going to transfer 285 from capital stabilization.
Second.
So move yeah, all right, second. All in favor?
Aye.
There you go. There you go. There's
the is that a unanimous?
Yeah.
All right, I'll tell you what, we'll go along we'll vote after they vote. Do we have a recommendation on that? Are we in concert with finance on that? We all set? So sure. 3-0 in voting? Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to throw one other little wrinkle in here, if you could. I don't know if you want to call it a 4 or what.
How late do you want to be here?
No,
what's the wrinkle?
This is such a...
I think there should be an article which requires the disposition of the old pumper.
An article?
Or something on the warrant. Or you can combine it with one of these.
What's your plan for that right now?
It's to dispose of it at a public auction.
If you don't,
like Dana said, if you don't put it in writing, you won't be able to do it. Legally. Hmm.
What do we do? Declare it surplus? We declare it surplus?
Yeah.
And then
have a public auction
at all?
Yeah.
Okay, do we want to add that to, we need a separate warrant article, or do we want to add that?
Seems like we could just add it.
Put it in 3, I would think.
Yeah, 3 or 4. I'd rather put it in 4, because if 3 doesn't, if 3 passes and 4 doesn't, or for some odd reason, we want to make sure that the whole thing passes. But it's really just a vote to authorize
the sale of the old pumper.
Do we need a warrant article for that?
I don't think we need a warrant article. Unless there was a specific thing you had in mind for the means of disposition, but I think a public auction is the way we're actually required to do it.
As long as it gets disposed of.
Mm-hmm. All right, the select board can authorize that. We don't need to go to town meeting.
He's going to drive it out the back of the garage.
So. I just don't want to see another situation like
that. Right, exactly.
Yeah. All right, well, you two can coordinate on that, right? Okay. All right, Article 5, Jim.
This is the 125 back into capital stabilization, so I move we Finance Committee recommend that.
So that's 5-0.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right, I'll make a motion that we recommend Article 5.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, 3-0. Number 6, Jim.
I would move the Finance Committee recommend Article 6, 100,000 for the highway garage stabilization.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right.
Again,
the funding sources, some of this is going to have to come from raise and appropriate. That'll be the voters' decision.
I don't think I'm on.
You know,
listen.
We'll figure out the funding sources, and if people don't want to raise and appropriate it, then it'll get voted down on the floor of town meeting.
All right. Well, this is from free cash. Number 6 is from free cash.
It shouldn't be. I don't think at this point we're making a decision on the funding source. We're just voting to recommend it or not.
Right. That's what we're doing now.
No. Yeah, whether it's free cash or not, we're not determining that tonight.
That's right.
Okay.
Okay. All right. So you recommended that. I'll make a motion that we recommend Article 6. Have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. 7.
7 is the 50 grand for the Conway Grammar School stabilization. And again, I move the Finance Committee recommend that.
7.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. 5-0. Okay. I'll make a motion that we recommend Article 7.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. 8.
So this is a, again, we just heard about this from Tom. This is taking money that's left over in the winter roads. It looked like there was going to be about 50 grand there that was going to close out to free cash. This would be consuming that for this engineering plan, which would trigger, I guess, funding from FEMA, MEMA, plus a future commitment from the town would be required?
A grant application to FEMA, MEMA, which may or may not be
accepted.
Funded. If it is funded, it will be funded 75% of the construction cost.
Right.
So we would still pay about $75,000 if it were a $300,000 project, which is in the upper end. It could be 250, could be 300.
So I don't know if you guys have seen what's going on over there in Delabari. That's by Owesco. It runs through there, right next to the river. It's a steep, high bank there, and it's just the rain is just eroding the bank, and they threw some rocks in there, and it's
we're losing the road.
It's going down into the river. So I think this is obviously. I think the fire department uses that for accessing.
Absolutely not.
But when it's in good shape, that's
absolutely not.
Well, that's not a road that the fire department uses.
What are you talking on? What, Delaware Avenue?
I thought that was like a key emergency route through town or something.
Oh, the route is for access. Yeah, short up to Delaware Avenue or stuff. Sure. Otherwise, you got to go way downtown to go back up through.
Or go up to Ives.
Or go up to Ives.
Come
down
around.
And Ives sometimes can be muddy and messy and
yeah, it can be.
I won't tell you how many years we sunk town trucks up there in the spring.
Yeah. I've been through there, Ben, brother.
So, do you guys have any questions about this business?
No, they're not taking out our taxes. We're just moving.
It's coming from free cash, basically.
Yeah, yeah, it's fiscal year 16 money.
Yeah. Yeah.
The other option you could do is take it out of his road machine. I mean, it's take it out of the funds for the state work. We get over $100,000 left in
Chapter 90
monies.
Well, he certainly has plans for Chapter 90 and not enough for the plans that he has. This is money that would be otherwise spent.
Right. If we don't do this, this would go to free cash.
Go to free cash.
Yeah. I mean, it's an interesting opportunity. I think it bears consideration. I'm not sure that I'm ready to make a recommendation on it, having just seen it tonight. So
I was hoping that was a way to raise the free cash just a little bit.
Yeah. All right, you want to skip A for right now?
For right now, I mean, I think unless someone wants to move a vote on this, I think we're probably not going to have a recommendation on it.
Okay. Yeah. What's happening here is this can go from winter roads to the engineering for Delabar. Once we do engineering, then we can get a FEMA MEMA grant. If we don't do anything, apply for it.
Yeah.
Okay. We don't get anywhere unless we do this first.
So, and you think that if the Finance Committee doesn't recommend it one way or the other, it's going to
We can just say no
fall
recommendation.
Down? I mean, I don't know.
No recommendation is fine if the Select Board is okay with it.
We want no recommendation, just state you guys didn't make your mind.
I mean, do you guys want to take a vote on it? Do you have your minds made up?
If you don't feel comfortable at this point because you don't know enough about it, you don't have to take a vote.
That's what I'm saying, but I'm asking the committee if other folks wanted to vote on it.
We didn't really know too much about the fire truck, the pumper, all the particulars like Dana was saying when we took a vote on it.
Yeah. We also found out about that 10 years ago.
We better fix the road.
Yeah, so you have to fix the road. There's no question about it.
Okay, do you want to recommend what this article says,
I mean,
or do you want to go no recommendation?
There's a motion then. All right. So you're moving to recommend that article? All right. So we got a motion. Is there a second to recommend Article 8 for $42,000 from Winter Roads?
I second it.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous.
I'm not voting.
Are you abstaining?
I'm not voting.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's 4-0-1.
Okay. All right. I'll make a motion that we accept Article 8.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Article 9.
So this is the 300,000 for the 250th?
No, it's 30,000. Were you here when...
30,000, rather, yeah.
Were you here when...
Yeah, he was.
Heidi and Katie came in and explained.
I think most of us were here that night, yeah.
Okay. Do you have a recommendation on that?
We'll see. Is there a motion?
I have to abstain from it. I'm on the committee.
Right, okay, so you have to abstain. If there's not a motion, I'm not going to move it. So if someone else wants to move it, this is one of those ones that I'm not sure about.
Let the town meeting discuss.
Okay, so it sounds like there's going to be no recommendation from the Finance Committee on this one.
See what the town says? No rec. Okay. I'll make a motion that we approve Article 9. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye, yeah. See what the town says.
This is the $20,000 for general stabilization. I move we recommend that. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. That's unanimous.
All right, I'll move that we approve Article 10.
Second.
How's that coming out, John? John's come out of what?
That's a reason appropriate.
Aye.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye, okay.
Mr. Chairman, do you have any further need for my services?
Go. Well, unless you want to stay and have fun with us, Dana.
Dana, 7 o'clock, when is it at the firehouse?
7 o'clock. I'll be there.
Thank you, Dana.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kathy.
Marie and Meg, you can come and join us if you want. You don't have to be shy back there.
How long we didn't know.
You know,
I thought there would be more people.
Come and have fun with us.
Hey, we've been having fun.
Oh, yeah, we've been
very excited. Yeah, yeah. Making snide remarks. Yep.
Another 10 articles.
You didn't hear any of those, did you?
Yes, I did.
Another 10 articles.
I know, we heard.
Article 11, Jim. For Article 11, I just do have one question, Tom.
Yes.
According to Joyce, as of January 31st, the balance in ambulance receipts is $46,103. If we're going to move, and so this, the number that you've got here for going into stabilization, this is actually the figure that should be in Article 12. So the 21,972 is the value that goes instead of the 15,000 in Article 12.
For operating.
So we're just moving the numbers around to fix the warrant. So Article 11, he's got 21,972. That's actually the figure that needs to go into defray their operating expenses. There's a different number for the stabilization, mm-hmm. in other words, what I'm saying.
Okay.
All right, so we're gonna change Article 11 to 24,131.
You're gonna change 11.
So right now, as of the best I know, as of January 31st, and this is a couple months ago, there's probably more in there now, the balance of the receipts reserved account was 24,131.
Yeah, okay.
To defray the ambulance operating budget, we need the 21,972. He put it in the wrong place. Okay? See the number on Article 11, 21,972?
Yeah.
That's not the transfer to stabilization. That's the number to go into the operating budget with the 15 to make the operating budget. So the number that goes here is 24,131.
All right, I'll just change ambulance stabilization fund to operating.
Or change the fund, whatever. Either.
So 15,000 to.
No, it's 15 plus 21,972, right?
He recommended changing Article 11 to 24,131.
Yes, that's what I'm recommending.
That's the amount of money that's in the account.
No, that'll be the amount of money that's in the account after we pull out the money for their operating expenses.
Oh. All right, so it's
so you
24,
want the operating expenses
it's 24
first.
Plus 15.
It doesn't matter what order we do them in.
All right.
There's only 46,000 in there, so we're going to take what we need for the operating budget, and the balance we're going to dump it into stabilization.
What are you suggesting for operating?
The operating is this number here, 21,972. But Article 12 is the operating one.
Okay.
The language of Article 12 is for the operating expense.
Okay, so
For the stabilization, you want the balance.
Which is 24,131.
24,131.
That was as of January 31st. There may be more money in there now. If we can get an update from Joyce, we can maybe increase that a little bit. But that's where it is right now.
Yeah, she did not have an update today.
I'm sorry, this is...
No, that's good. That's good. Thank you.
All right, so the changes...
So the figure for Article 11 is 24,131.
For ambulance stabilization.
24,131 for Article 11. That's going into ambulance stabilization?
Yep. And actually, the funding source is clear. It's not raise and appropriate or whatever, whatever. This is...
Transfer
from receipts reserved.
Yes.
That would be otherwise provided.
Yeah, well, it's not going to be anything else, so I think we can...
All right, and then 12 is the 15,000.
No. 15,000 is on Article 2. 12 is the 21,972.
Right.
Also from receipts reserved.
Also from receipts reserved, correct.
Can you check with Joyce on this?
Oh, yes. I'm going to check with Joyce on the whole...
So the appropriate raise appropriate goes away.
Okay. Yeah, raise
so
appropriate.
So just for the record, one of the things that I learned from Tom today is that receipts reserved bears no interest. So we should, at town meeting every year, we shouldn't just leave the money sitting in there. We transfer it every year. I don't know if we always have.
Yeah,
but,
we do.
But
every
we
year
make
we transfer.
Sure that we don't skip a year.
Okay, so
we did skip a year once.
So now we have the numbers right on 11 and 12. All right, what's your recommendation on 11?
I move we approve Article 11 with the 24,131.
Second.
All in favor?
Yeah.
Aye. 5-0. And Article 12.
Same.
I move we approve that one. That's the for the operating expenses of the ambulance company, 21,972. All
second.
In favor? Or second? All right. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, so there you go.
Same time? Yeah, I'll make a recommendation that we approve both Article 11 and 12. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, Article 13.
So this is the 10,000 for the triennial reval, and it sounds like probably got the money in overlay to cover this, which
it's
we've had in the past.
Overlay surplus.
Yes. So that'll be the funding source. But that one's pretty clear when the time comes. But I would move we recommend Article 13, the 10,000 for the reval.
I second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right, that's unanimous.
All right, I'll make a motion that we approve Article 13. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Article 14.
Is there going to be a motion on Article 14, 3,000 for the Visual Gov budget application?
I haven't seen Visual Gov.
I tried to take a look at it.
We haven't discussed this ourselves.
It's worthwhile.
We said that we were going to present it to the townspeople at that site.
Right.
This guy's apparently going to be at the town meeting. Give a little demo.
Can we all do a non-note recommendation? Or no recommendation?
We recommend it that we send it to town. The voters can vote.
This
what do you want to do with it, Jim?
People understand this to a certain extent.
Did anybody take a look at it?
Okay. It helps the town people.
I tried. There's a couple of different ones. I didn't get very far with it.
Have you spent any time looking at it?
Yeah. Okay. Make a motion
to recommend
Article 14, $3,000 for Visual Gov budget presentation. Software which basically helps people grasp what's happening to their town budget better than perhaps anything else.
Is there a second?
A good
Government for Dummies?
No.
That's not what it is.
The budget.
Budget, we don't have, is it budget?
Is there a second on this?
It's, it dies from charge.
But it doesn't look like there's going to be a recommendation from the Finance Committee.
No recommendation.
I tried.
Okay. I'll make a motion that we approve Article 14. Do we have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Are you going to explain to them that we're just, it wasn't a vote in support of it, it's just a vote that we are bringing it up to the board, to those townspeople?
Well, the fact that it's on the warrant. Oh, submitted by town.
Yeah, if the board didn't recommend it, I would take it off the warrant.
Okay, well, we'll leave it off.
It's a fine.
Okay.
And there's going to be a guy there to explain, there's somebody there.
Yeah, okay, Article 15.
So it stays on the warrant?
Yes.
Okay.
Article 15.
This is the $2,125 for the library. And Tom, can you clarify, this is the piece that the town does need to kick in?
Yes.
To keep the interlibrary loan service or whatever?
We do this every year.
We do this every year, right.
We do get money from the state, but we also have to provide money through a town appropriation in order for this library to keep its certification, which allows it to engage in interlibrary loan.
And where does this figure come from, the 21?
That's the average of the last 3 years the town has put in plus 2.5%. Not 2.5%, 0.025.
This money come back to the town in Ottawa?
Through the services of your local library. Is how it comes back to the town.
It doesn't come back to the town.
The Finance Committee recommend, or it doesn't come back financially.
But as if I might make a statement, an awful lot of towns have a town library that's supported by the town.
Mm-hmm. We don't.
And because this is privately funded for the most part.
Cheap.
It's sort of a mandate of the state. Mm-hmm. It's really cheap to have the great library we have.
Right.
So I'd like to take Article...
Were you unanimous on that?
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
I'll make a motion that we accept Article 15.
Second.
Yes.
Okay.
3-0.
I don't know why it says 4-0. I think I copied it from last year.
Article 16.
So I'd like to take Article 16, 17, and 18 together. I would move that we, Finance Committee, recommend all three of those. That's $400 for Open Space Committee, $250 for the Ag Commission, and $200 for the U.S. Flag Fund.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
I'll do the same thing. I'll recommend that we take 16, 17, and 18 and approve them. I have second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Very good. They're big amounts. Okay, 19.
So we're not going to do 19 because it's just the CBA.
Oh, that's coming. Okay, right.
No recommendation there. And then that leaves us with Article 20 and 21, which are sort of like these pipeline-related ones.
All right, wait, hold on a second. We're going to... I'll make a motion that we accept Article 19. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Go ahead, Jim. Article 20.
Now, is Meg here to speak about this? Or?
Yeah.
Right, okay.
Go, Marie.
And Mario. First of all, for the first one.
So this is Article 20, which is the 20 grand for the private well water and air quality testing.
Oh, it's already down to 20.
Okay, yeah. So actually, we revised numbers in the Board Health meeting tonight to 19.4. So we nudged it down.
It's kind of a precise number.
Yes.
We're trying to be.
So the how we came up with the number that we now have is looking at water tests that the Mario has a... put together sort of a recommendation of the minimum things that you would want to test to get baseline for water. And those tests are come in right around $200 per test.
How many residents are affected?
We are looking at 50.
We're looking at 50. Offering, yeah. If you think about where...
You're only within so many feet of the pipeline, you're going to do it.
Well, the bylaw requires Kinder Morgan to pay for anything within 1,000 feet of the pipeline. Our concern is, what about the folks that are just outside of that, once they do the blasting and horizontal drilling?
So Kinder Morgan is doing everything, paying for everything within 1,000 feet of the
pipeline? The bylaw that we passed at the special town meeting has that provision.
Okay, so this is for...
This is
how far outside?
Well, I would say we would look at those residences that are closest.
I would think you need to spell the distance out in your article.
Okay.
Because that, otherwise, that opens up to the whole town of Conway.
Well, I think what we tried to put in the is that we would do a predetermined baseline sample. I'm not a hydrogeologist, so I can't look at the terrain at that end of town and say this is, you know, would be the most vulnerable wells.
So there may be different distances depending upon the topography.
Right. Yeah, so exactly. I would want a recommendation. You know, we have more homework to do on this, but my concern was, if there's somebody whose house is 1,200 feet and they lose their well because of this project, and there's no way to demonstrate that the quality or the quantity of their water prior, then they have no recourse.
She need to establish a zone, is what it sounds like.
Well, it's. I had trouble coming up with the distance because I'm not a geologist. I don't understand the underlying geology. So
you estimate 94 households are going to be affected by this.
Excuse me?
You're planning on 94 households being affected by this. $200 a household.
We're talking about, because there's air and water, 50. So we're talking about 50 water tests.
Oh, okay.
And then the air tests, we were talking about 12 air tests, and those would be samples. Mm-hmm. Again, we would look to probably the group that's out of Yale that's done studies like this in southeast Pennsylvania to help us determine where those air samples would be. Looking at where the proposed location of the main line valve.
May I ask a question?
Yeah.
So is this to cover if Kinder Morgan doesn't abide by our bylaw and do the testing within 1,000 feet? Or is this to supplement that and test people who are outside, that's assuming that they're going to cover that?
It's assuming they're going to cover within that 1,000.
And this is for the outside of
it. Yeah.
Okay, right. All right, sorry, I didn't understand that. Right.
Is there a contingency if the assumption's wrong?
Contingency?
Which assumption?
That Kinder Morgan's going to cover inside 1,000 feet.
Have a class action suit to pay for your house.
If they get the okay, I don't think they're going to.
Well, they'd have to fight the bylaw. I mean, if it's accepted by the Attorney General's office, then...
Well, yeah, but I mean, if they get it, they've gone around the state constitution, too. I don't know if the state constitution is Ben's tool, and I don't think a town bylaw will do much.
Well, we'll know more after this week, possibly.
So let's postpone this vote.
We got to have this done basically tonight.
Well, I thought Tom said earlier, you're not signing it until next week.
I don't know. They're not going to make a decision. The hearings are, there's hearings tomorrow and Thursday.
Yeah.
Has it been approved that the pipeline's coming?
No.
It has not been, FERC is still asking Kinder Morgan and asked them again for additional information today.
They did give them okay for the...
For the Stannisfield, for that, yes, that loop they have. Yeah. But the conventional wisdom is that that's a test case for the article 97.
Yeah.
Are you going to speak to this article at the town meeting?
Yeah.
Okay.
And we can, we can see what we can get in terms of being clearer about how the sample of properties would be determined.
Because you'll know a lot more by town meeting.
I'm hoping.
Okay.
I'm hoping. I've got April vacation.
Do you have any recommendation on this?
Do you want to make a motion?
So, motion to recommend Article 20, the amount of $19,000 and change.
$400.
$400.
Second.
All right.
All in favor?
All in favor.
Aye.
All opposed? I didn't vote on that one, so.
Any abstain?
I abstain.
You abstain, so we have.
So it's a three, we have, it's a 3-0-2?
This is the second way it's written, it's a predetermined sample.
Sometimes it's still.
It wasn't our intent, but.
If it becomes.
I don't trust them, rascals, so.
I don't trust them, I hear.
All right, I'll make a motion that we accept Article 20. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right, 21, Jim.
All right, so Article 21, this is the $5,000 for the town of Montague initiative regarding, the pipeline too, yeah.
I know. So.
What exactly is this?
So, the town of Montague filed for intervener status in the DPU proceedings for the supply path of the proposed pipeline. Right, there's two sections of the proposed pipeline. But the proceedings of the DPU have to do with the capacity that Kinder Morgan has claims that they have committed for the proposed pipeline. And capacity is the bottom line key issue with this pipeline, because without demonstrated need, FERC presumably cannot approve the pipeline. So the DPU proceedings is part of that need assessment, if you will.
Well, and part of that need is also the fact that Kinder Morgan has to have contracts for the gas coming through that line.
Right, and so that's what part of these proceedings are with the DPU and with Berkshire Gas's proposed contract. So the only entity that was awarded intervener status in the DPU proceedings is the town of Montague.
And the reason for that?
They could claim that they were directly and significantly impacted, as they are a town that has Berkshire Gas customers. So, like, the town of Conway wouldn't have made sense to.
Because we don't have any gas customers.
We don't have any gas customers.
Okay.
But what Montague is trying to do is, by intervening in that, it gives their legal counsel and their expert access to information. It's very prescripted who has access to that information, because there's all kinds of non-disclosure agreements and such. So it's not like we're going to get that information.
Right.
We will not. But the town of Montague's attorney and their expert in the matter will get that and can then weigh in.
So this would be for the attorney.
It would be for Montague to help, or for Conway to help Montague in understanding this
and examining the
need.
Yeah, what's the benefit to Conway?
It helps to establish whether there is need for this project, for this proposal. And if there's no demonstrated need, then
pipeline ceased to exist.
That works.
Is the information that they have access to, can that help us in any way?
I don't think we get direct access to that information. My understanding is we won't get direct access to that information. Will it help us in any way? I think ultimately it will help towns along the route, but I'm not aware, and I don't want to say what I don't want to say what we would get.
So we don't know what the benefit would be for us.
Well, no, she said
it's for the common good.
I think the benefit is raising the question. It's a concrete procedural process that looks at, is there established, is there need, are these contracts viable, and is there need
So it speaks to the need question.
The need for the whole pipeline?
Yeah.
The need for the local...
Not just Montague's portion.
Yeah, for the whole pipeline.
Because it's...
For the demand, this is about the demand for the gas around here, as opposed to if it's going to be exported.
Not even around here, it's...
Period.
Right, it's in order for FERC to approve a pipeline, there has to be a certain amount of capacity of that pipeline that is contracted for. So this proceeding... This proceeding is part of that sort of approval of those proposed contracts. If this proposed contract that with Berkshire Gas is not approved by the DPU, then Kinder Morgan doesn't have that capacity for the proposed pipeline.
How much of the gas has to be contracted for?
It's I think right now they're 41% is contracted for. And usually it has to be
two-thirds or something.
Like that.
Well, that's what they said also. 70%. Is that proven, or does this help verify that what they say is actually what it is?
Only if an intervener do you know that.
So, I can't answer that question.
So is this
sorry.
Questioning the validity of the contracts?
That would be part of it, I would imagine.
It's questioning the need, so in that sense, yes. It's my understanding.
And one of the things is Kinder Morgan and TGP stonewalled giving anybody any information, it seems.
Well, they are prevented from giving out confidential business information as part of the normal circumstance, and this would allow counsel for the opposition, if I may put it that way, access to that data.
Okay. Does finance have a recommendation on this?
Yeah, I move we recommend Article 21, $5,000 for towards the town of Montague for this sort of pipeline related initiative.
I second.
All in favor?
Yeah. Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Any abstainers? All right, that sounded like that was.
I'll make a motion to approve Article 21.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, ladies.
Thank you very much.
We're going to leave you to the rest of the
do you not want to stay for the sports revolving account?
Oh, come on, man. Good luck with that. No, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, ladies. Article 22. Jim?
Thank you.
I think that's all the financial ones. Oh, this is a sports revolving account.
Board of Director.
Well, it's asking for a revolving account, which is not going, its whole purpose is to keep it from having a financial impact beyond its participants.
Okay, this is related to the new Parks and Rec budget. Yeah, okay. I would move the
same article that was on last year. This year they have definitively decided that they want it.
Yeah, I would move that the Finance Committee recommend Article 22 to establish a Conway Sports revolving account. Can I get a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Any abstainers?
Could you run that by me? What that means again, a revolving account? I'm not a very good financial person.
So it means that if they charge people to participate, that money will go into an account that is then available to them to pay a coach or whatever it is that they're going to pay. Now, I know that we...
So we give them $20,000 as seed money and then...
No,
this is for they charge fees to the kids. You know, we got to pay like, whatever, $20 for your kid to play T-ball. That goes into this account and then they spend it out of that account. So instead of having their own checking account up at wherever...
Yeah, there's still a question: is whoever they hire, are they engaged by the town? Whoever's hired, are they?
Yes, it will be a town function. I actually have a draft job description.
So it's another.
There are requirements that will go with a position, and the $20,000 is that they are prohibited from spending more than $20,000 on the program in any year. That is, it puts limits on the amount that they can expend. It's a way of controlling expenses.
All right, what's the vote for finance on that, Jim? What do you have over there?
So this is, we're not, yeah, the vote was a little, so we got, how many in favor?
Can I see?
All right, you got three and two abstentions, is that what you have?
Okay, so that's what it is.
Okay, 3-0 to 2. Okay. I'll make a motion that we accept Article 22. Do you have a second?
That, just with one little addition. I don't want this to be a backdoor for putting in those backstop things or whatever they were trying to do.
Yeah, no, this is just to set the account, Jim.
Okay.
Okay. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
I'll abstain.
Okay, so 2-0-1. Okay. Article 23.
Account spending and revenue fund here.
And Doug Finn, formerly of Franklin Frontier Community Access TV, was in earlier today, and he explained that the Department of Revenue has come up with new rules governing the provision of the public educational and government access channel. And part of that is that we will have to go out to bid for their services to make sure that we are getting, that there's competition for, or if there is competition for it, that it's allowed to exist. And that's the reason at the end of this article that the select board would be authorized to enter into contracts of up to 10 years with the PEG access provider. This is a way to keep this from coming up too often. I mean, FCAT has been providing our services for quite some time. We don't believe there will be any other bidders. Whoever wins the bid, we want consistency and stability, and so that's what this is about. New DOR rules.
That doesn't need your vote, does it?
There's no amount.
I don't think it needs your vote, do you? No. Think?
It's setting up another special revenue account as part of it, so transferring money into whatever they have into it, I guess. So, I mean, we can recommend it. It is financial, it is about the financial.
How much is it?
Money is related. But.
There isn't one, they want to set up one.
Oh, there's no existing PEG access account?
There is an account, but it hasn't been established under Chapter 44, okay. Section 53, F and 3/4.
So you just want to make it under the chapter?
Yeah. I'll move that the Finance Committee recommend Article 26.
Second. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right. Is that unanimous? There you go.
All right. I'll recommend. I'd
rather Comcast had competition.
I'll make a motion that we accept Article 26.
I second that.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
You gotta go back here and do it.
Yeah. Thank you, guys.
Thanks a lot.
All right, Article 23. Everybody understand?
Yeah, we're done, right?
We're done. Good job, folks. See you.
All right, I'll make a motion that we accept Article 23.
Meeting adjourned.
Second.
So is there
all in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Article 24.
Okay. One more.
This is similar to the provision on the other one, where this is also a DOR recommendation from the.
That's pretty obvious, right?
Yeah.
Review they did a while back.
Yep.
Allows you to enter into long-term contract.
Right.
Thank you.
All right. I'll make a motion. We accept Article 24.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Article 25. Town authorize the select board to close town roads in case of dangerous driving conditions or take any other action. Yeah, we've already, you know, voted on this at select board meetings.
It's been a policy, this would make it a bylaw.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, I'll make a motion.
Did you run that by our town council?
Yes.
What did he say?
He said, yeah.
He was fine. Somebody needs to make that decision.
Yeah, somebody does.
Yeah, I'll second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Article 27.
And the registry of vehicles, that's the one we talked about.
Joe gave us a little rundown on this one.
Yeah.
Make a motion that we accept Article 27.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Article 28 is basically the sister article to that, that Joe gave us a rundown on. I'll make a motion that we accept Article 28.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, Article 29, we talked about this with, did we talk about this with this, Tom?
29 was the Energy Committee. This is expanding the district that was approved as part of the Green Communities program.
Right, okay. And we're adding just a couple of parcels to that?
Yes.
Okay.
By the school, but not where the garage would be.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, right.
All right, I'll make a motion that we accept this order.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Article 30, see if the town will dissolve the Festival of the Hills Committee and the Festival of the Hills Scholarship Board.
I did check this out with the committee over a long period of time. They do intend to go private. They think they would prefer to work that way, and they're willing to speak to that. The way it would work is whatever money they've accumulated, we would then hire them to put on the festival, and they would put on the festival, mm-hmm. and we would pay them. And that way, the money that came into the town would
say
be spent.
Say that again. Can you just say that again?
They have a certain amount of money, and that they want to be able to keep and use
control
for the festival with the hills.
Yeah, I understand that.
And so it's town money. Because they're a town group. So in order for them to continue to have access to that money after they go private, all we have to do is enter into a contract with them to perform the service of putting on the Festival of the Hills.
Okay.
For 1 year.
They have
for
the money.
Money for the 1 year.
Yeah.
They have. You made it sound like we were going to have to pay them every year to put this thing on.
No.
And more the money they make, they earn.
Yeah, and you know, it's been self-perpetuating for many years. They know what their budget
Thank you.
Is, so, all of that.
All right, I'll make a motion that we accept Article 30.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Article 31, to see if the town will hear a report of the Downtown Wastewater Feasibility Study Committee.
Sure. Yeah, sure. The town should hear it.
I'll make a motion that we accept Article 31.
Second.
Okay.
And I have the two questions on the town ballot down below, because the election is part of town meeting, just postponed for 3 days. The first question is the required question to have the town clerk position become appointed. So we have, this is the ballot vote that follows the town meeting vote from last year. After this ballot vote takes place, if it passes, then the select board would appoint a town clerk. I understand that the current town clerk does not intend to resign immediately, and that's probably a good thing in a presidential election year, as it's a complicated task. She will, I believe, want to retire sometime in the not too distant future, and at some point we'll have to think about a way of bringing someone on and keeping her available for some few hours to coach the new term clerk.
Yeah, right.
But that's what this is about. I will note that she does have a challenger in this election. If the challenger won, it would make for an awkward moment for the select board. And I would like to sit, if that happens, I'll like to sit down with you and the current town clerk and the one, and come to an agreement.
Okay.
So the second one is for the borrowing. So we vote at town meeting to borrow some money.
Yep.
That's debt excluded, and then we vote a few days later at the ballot vote to ratify that. And those are the two questions that I have to go on the warrant.
Okay. Okay, any other questions on our warrant? So we will be signing this next week. You got all the changes, Liz, that we need on this? Okay. Okay. Great work, you guys, on this, by the way.
It's the task, hasn't it?
Oh, very negative.
Still it is.
Lots of changes.
Okay, we got through that. Okay, anything non-anticipated 48 hours in advance of the meeting, Tom?
Not that I have.
No, you have any update? No?
You've heard them all.
Good. Okay. Concerns of the selectmen? No.
No.
Good. Mail. Do we get mail? What do we get mail for? No, I don't think we got any mail. Okay. Announcements, none. Next meeting, excuse me, is going to be April 4th. That's going to be in the town offices, Tom?
We don't have to meet with the finance committee.
Okay, so that's going to be town offices.
Town office. All right.
Okay, any other business to come before the board?
Not for me.
Okay, actually, we do have one piece of mail. That's from Mass Tech that says, it is a pleasure to inform you that we received unanimous support through a voice vote of the MBI Board of Directors today to proceed with negotiations with Comcast for cable extensions for the seven towns where Comcast was the only respondent to the RFQ. And, of course, Conway is one of those towns. And that was a vote that was taken on March 24th. That was last Thursday. So they're moving ahead with the extension of the cable system here in Conway to get it up to, is it 98%?
So, 97.9%,
I think, okay,
is how they put it.
All right. Good.
Mm-hmm. Higher than we thought.
Very, very much higher. At least 3% higher. Okay, if there's no other business come before the board, I'll make a motion that we adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Gentlemen, thank you.
Yep.
Good meeting.
Thank you very much.